Please rise as you are able. Almighty God, look with loving mercy on your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed, to be given over to the hands of sinners, and to suffer death on the cross, who now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
The Passion of Jesus according to Matthew. Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee and began to be grieved and agitated. Then he said to them, "I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and stay awake with me." And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Yet not what I want, but what you want." Then he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, "So could you not stay awake with me 1 hour? Stay awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." Again, he went away for the second time and prayed, "My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done." Again, he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the third time, saying the same words. Then he came to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand."
While Jesus was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd with swords and clubs, from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him." At once he came up to Jesus and said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus said to him, "Friend, do what you are here to do." And they came and laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. Suddenly, one of those with Jesus put his hand on his sword, drew it, and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to him, "Put your sword back into its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father, and he will at once send me more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled, which say it must happen in this way?" At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds, "Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day, I sat in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But all this has taken place so that the scriptures of the prophets may be fulfilled." Then all the disciples deserted him and fled.
Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, in whose house the scribes and the elders had gathered. But Peter was following him at a distance, as far as the courtyard of the high priest. And going inside, he sat with the guards in order to see how this would end. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for false testimony against Jesus so that they might put him to death. But they found none, though many false witnesses came forward. At last, two came forward and said, "This fellow said, 'I am able to destroy the temple of God and build it in 3 days.'" The high priest stood up and said, "Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?" But Jesus was silent. Then the high priest said to him, "I put you under oath before the living God. Tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God." Jesus said to him, "You have said so. But I tell you, from now on, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his clothes and he said, "He has blasphemed. Why do we still need witnesses? You have now heard his blasphemy. What is your verdict?" They answered, "He deserves death." Then they spat in his face and struck him, and some slapped him, saying, "Prophesy to us, you Messiah. Who is it that struck you?"
Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. A servant girl came to him and said, "You also were with Jesus the Galilean." But he denied it before all of them, saying, "I do not know what you are talking about." When he went out to the porch, another servant girl saw him, and she said to the bystanders, "This man was with Jesus of Nazareth." Again, he denied it with an oath, "I do not know the man." After a little while, the bystanders came up and said to Peter, "Certainly you are also one of them, for your accent betrays you." Then he began to curse, and he swore an oath, "I do not know the man." At that moment, the cock crowed. Then Peter remembered what Jesus had said, "Before the cock crows, you will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly.
When morning came, all the chief priests and the elders of the people conferred together against Jesus in order to bring about his death. They bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate, the governor. When Judas, his betrayer, saw that Jesus was condemned, he repented and brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and the elders. He said, "I have sinned by betraying innocent blood." But they said, "What is that to us? See to it yourself." Throwing down the pieces of silver in the temple, he departed, and he went and hanged himself. But the chief priests, taking the pieces of silver, said, "It is not lawful to put them into the treasury, since they are blood money." After conferring together, they used them to buy the potter's field as a place to bury foreigners. For this reason, that field has been called the field of blood to this day. Then was fulfilled what had been spoken through the prophet Jeremiah. And they took the 30 pieces of silver, the price of the one on whom a price had been set, on whom some of the people of Israel had set a price, and they gave them for the potter's field, as the Lord commanded them.
Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus said, "You say so." But when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he did not answer. Then Pilate said to him, "Do you not hear how many accusations they make against you?" But he gave him no answer, not even to a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now at the festival, the governor was accustomed to release a prisoner for the crowd, anyone whom they wanted. At that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Jesus Barabbas. So after they had gathered, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release for you, Jesus Barabbas or Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that they had handed him over. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, "Have nothing to do with that innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal because of a dream about him." Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor again said to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release for you?" And they said, "Barabbas." Pilate said to them, "Then what should I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" All of them said, "Let him be crucified." Then he asked, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Let him be crucified." So when Pilate saw that he could do nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took some water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves." Then the people as a whole answered, "His blood be on us and our children."
So he released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. And after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. They put a reed in his right hand and knelt before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." They spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. After mocking him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. As they went out, they came upon a man from Cyrene named Simon. They compelled this man to carry his cross.
Perfect grace would be real.
And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull, they offered him wine to drink, mixed with gall. But when he tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his clothes among themselves by casting lots. Then they sat down there and kept watch over him. Over his head, they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then two bandits were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes and elders, were mocking him, saying, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now, if he wants to, for he said, 'I am God's son.'" The bandits who were crucified with him also taunted him in the same way. From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And about 3:00, Jesus cried with a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani," that is, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "This man is calling for Elijah." At once, one of them ran and got a sponge, filled it with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink. But the others said, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him."
Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks were split. The tombs also were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised.
Now when the centurion and those with him who were keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake and what took place, they were terrified and said, "Truly, this man was God's son." Many women were also there, looking on from a distance. They had followed Jesus from Galilee and had provided for him. Among them were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of the sons of Zebedee.
Thank you.
Many women were also there, looking on from a distance. We've all seen signs like this. They tell us no trespassing. Do not enter. Stay back. Signs that tell us to keep our distance. Signs that warn us off. That if we become too close, if we get too close, there will be consequences. At the crucifixion of Jesus, the women who had followed Jesus kept their distance. They couldn't come any closer. I imagine that they pressed. They pressed in as far as they could, straining to see Jesus. More importantly, maybe, so that Jesus could see them. So that he would know that he wasn't alone, that he had not been entirely abandoned. Someone had shown up for him. Yet they remained at a distance, being as present as they could be for their suffering teacher and friend. They showed up when others had scattered out of fear. Why, we might wonder, did they keep their distance? Why did they stay back? Maybe there was a physical barrier keeping the distance, maybe a wall or a fence of some kind that divided, an insurmountable obstacle that was physically separating them from Jesus. Or maybe it was a military perimeter, soldiers stationed around Golgotha, keeping watch over the executions so that no one could get too close to the crucified. No trespassing signs making it clear that stepping over the line would not be tolerated. Rome would have wanted the bystanders to see, to be close enough to see, but to be far enough away that those who were sentenced to death would feel utterly and completely alone. They'd want it this way, to broadcast the bone-chilling threat of the empire's violence, but to make certain that no loved one could come close enough to offer any real assistance to the condemned. Or maybe it was an emotional barrier, no less potent, holding them at a distance. Jesus was enduring unspeakable suffering. No doubt it was traumatic for those who loved him, who did not turn away in grief or revulsion. Watching this, not turning away from this, to be in the same zip code as this kind of suffering would have been hard, but to come close, overwhelming. This would have been too much to bear, maybe. So maybe the distance was a boundary keeping, a buffer, a space that made it possible for the women to remain steadfast, to stay with Jesus, watching and praying till the end, to hold the space, so that Jesus' abandonment was never complete. Or maybe it was an almost mystical barrier. The awe that you experience when you're close to something with great power, the charge in the air when you're standing next to something with a sign that says high voltage. Maybe there was something intrinsic to Jesus that signaled a transformational power from which you might want to keep your distance. A kind of potential energy that could be unleashed at any second, a spiritual charge. After all, it seems that a remarkable power is unleashed at the moment of Jesus' death. The earth quakes. The temple is torn in two. The dead rise. And those who are closest to Jesus, in physical proximity to him at that moment, the same soldiers who had taunted Jesus just minutes before, now confess, truly, this man was God's son. What was it that they saw standing up close? What was the power they experienced? These were boundaries the women could not cross. And so they remained at a distance. A distance they could not close. The women looked on from a distance.
because there were real barriers. They weren't going to be able to change Pontius Pilate's sentence. They had no power to confront the religious leaders who'd lied about Jesus. They could do nothing to save Jesus. Instead, they had the courage to not turn away, but to be present to one another and to Jesus when there was quite literally nothing they could do to save him. Now that's courage. That's faith. Maybe in many ways we still keep our distance. These barriers and the distance they create remain today between us and the crucified one. I mean, think about this. We'll show up. We showed up tonight. We'll show up unless something gets in the way. Unless the emotional load feels unmanageable. As long as there's limited risk that we're going to be transformed. Because God forbid that coming close to the crucified Christ would change us, right? Maybe when this cross stuff gets too real, when it hits too close to home, we lean out. We put a little more distance between us and Jesus. And it's understandable. That's what Peter and the other disciples did. Or maybe like the women disciples, when these very real boundaries show up, we'll press them as far as we can. We'll lean in. We'll remain. Never closing the gap entirely, but not for lack of effort. Because the truth is, when we try to get where Jesus is, when we try to close the distance through our own efforts, we find this is a distance we cannot close. Because the barriers are real, we can't come any closer. But here's the thing. On the cross, God has closed the distance, coming to us. In Jesus, God breaks through the barriers that divide us, that hold us apart, trespassing on human-held property, where the posted threat is violators will be crucified. God trespasses in a space violently protected by those in power. God occupies it, knowing well the consequences, knowing that Jesus would be put to death for stepping over the line. And Jesus knew too. He saw the signs posted everywhere. He told the disciples, "I must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering and be killed." You see, in Jesus, God joins us in our sufferings completely. The distance is closed. God meets us in whatever human suffering is greatest, identifying perfectly with those who suffer, with those who are oppressed, with those who face death, in the hungry, in the lonely, in the abandoned. You see, in Jesus, God unleashes the power of grace and forgiveness in a world with no tolerance for it. A power contrary to the ways of the world. A power that shakes the world still. Power not revealed in acts of vengeance and violence and might, but in the paradox of powerlessness. A power in the pouring out of God's life for the world, in God's willingness through Jesus to suffer to the point of death, even death on a cross. When we join the women and look upon the cross from the insurmountable distance of miles and millennia, when we strain our weary eyes to gaze on the crucified one, when we lean in despite the barriers and choose not to give in to the temptation to turn away, then we discover that God does not look on us from a distance. In the life and death of the crucified one, God is with us and for us. There is no space between. When we look upon the cross from a distance, we find not only that Jesus is crucified, but the idea that our job is to get to God is put to death too. Beloved, we cannot get to God because God has already come to us. Look again, beloved. Look on the cross. And let it sharpen our focus for what it means to follow in the way of the crucified one. As one author writes, our task, a task made possible as well as demanded by the cross, is not to turn away, but to be present to one another when there is quite literally nothing we can do to save ourselves. Amen. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who was also a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be given to him. So Joseph took the body and wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his new tomb, which he had hewn in the rock. He then rolled a great stone to the door of the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were there, sitting opposite the tomb.
Let us pray, brothers and sisters, for the Holy Church throughout the world. Almighty and eternal God, you have shown your glory to all nations in Jesus Christ. By your Holy Spirit, guide the church and gather it throughout the world. Help it to persevere in faith, proclaim your name, and bring the good news of salvation in Christ to all people. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for Elizabeth and Anne, our bishops, for Katie, Adam, and Jim, our pastors, for Shane and Shannon, our Christian educators, and for all servants of the church, and for all the people of God. Almighty and eternal God, your Spirit guides the church and makes it holy. Strengthen and uphold our bishops, pastors, other ministers, and lay leaders. Keep them in health and safety for the good of the church, and help each of us in our various vocations to do faithfully the work to which you have called us. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for those preparing for baptism throughout the whole church. Almighty and eternal God, you continue to bless the church. Increase the faith and understanding of those preparing for baptism. Give them new birth as your children, and keep them in the faith and communion of your holy church. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for our sisters and brothers who share our faith in Jesus Christ. Almighty and eternal God, you give your church unity. Look with favor on all who follow Jesus, your Son. Make all the baptized one in the fullness of faith, and keep us united in the fellowship of love. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for the Jewish people, the first to hear the word of God. Almighty and eternal God, long ago you gave your promise to Abraham and your teaching to Moses. Hear our prayers that the people you called and elected as your own may receive the fulfillment of the covenant's promises. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for those who do not share our faith in Jesus Christ. Almighty and eternal God, gather into your embrace all those who call out to you under different names. Bring an end to interreligious strife and make us more faithful witnesses of the love made known to us in your Son. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for those who do not believe in God. Almighty and eternal God, you created humanity so that all may long to know you and find peace in you. Grant that all may recognize the signs of your love and grace in the world and in the lives of Christians, and gladly acknowledge you as the one true God. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for God's creation. Almighty and eternal God, you are the creator of a magnificent universe. Hold all the worlds in the arms of your care and bring all things to fulfillment in you. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for those who serve in public office. Almighty and eternal God, you are the champion of the poor and oppressed. In your goodness, give wisdom to those in authority, so that all people may enjoy justice, peace, and freedom, and a share in the goodness of your creation. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for those in need. Almighty and eternal God, you give strength to the weary and new courage to those who have lost heart. Heal the sick, comfort the dying, give safety to travelers, free those unjustly deprived of liberty, and deliver your world from falsehood, hunger, and disease. Hear the prayers of all who call on you in any trouble, that they may have the joy of receiving your help in their need.
We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Almighty and eternal God, we pray especially for Joyce Bruner, Gary Engstrom, Doug Schola, Dave Neubauer, Matt Elliott, Linda Wynn, Floyd Lovelett, Don Dorr, Sharon Dorr, Virginia Wright, Kelby Shane, Daryl Baumgartner, John Lubke, Barb Grangard, Joan Butler, Weldon Hins, Deb Netch, and Jim Bieland. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Finally, let us pray for all those things for which our Lord would have us ask. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Now we turn our hearts in gratitude to God and in service to our neighbor as we offer what we have for the sake of the church and the world.
Thank you.
Please rise as you are able. I invite you to face the cross at the back. Behold the life-giving cross on which was hung the Savior of the whole world. O come, let us worship him. Behold the life-giving cross on which was hung the Savior of the whole world. O come, let us worship him. Behold the life-giving cross on which was hung the Savior of the whole world.
O come, let us worship him.
We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you.
By your holy cross, you have redeemed the world.
Seated.